Languages change over time, but how fast? Let's say you fall into a coma, hearing your language spoken all around you. You snap awake, in the same place but at a different time. They're still speaking your language, but you can't understand a word. How long were you out? How long can a language last before it becomes unrecognizable? Last time we met an eccentric Australian tongue called Gerbil, a language where nouns can be edible or harmful, where you have to talk completely differently around your in-laws, and where speaking vaguely is considered a serious flaw, and they don't even have a word for language. At least it used to be that way, because when linguists came back to visit the Dyirbalngan decades later, their language had changed. Then we heard from Swadesh, who argued that, actually, no, all languages change at the same pace, replacing core vocabulary at a constant rate, keeping over 80% of their most basic words after 1,000 years. Swadesh then used his vocabulary lists and calculations to draw a line, marking how long we'd expect to wait before dialects of a single language evolve into separate tongues. A line in the sand, the elusive moment of change itself. Spot any problems with this idea? These researchers sure did. They grabbed their Swadesh lists and pointed them at two sibling languages, Norwegian and Icelandic. The basic question they wanted Swadesh to answer was this: how many years had passed between Old Norse and Norwegian, and how many between Old Norse and Icelandic? Looking at word lists for replacement, plugging that stable rate assumption, it looks like Norwegian diverged 1,000 years ago. Not a bad estimate, actually. While modern Icelandic is 200-something years old. In other words, no one should be speaking Icelandic right now. Call up Iceland, your language is a mistake. The numbers don't lie. Today, thanks to debunkings like this, and the fact that Icelandic exists, historical linguists accept that the rate of language change varies, and for various reasons. According to this paper, one factor could be population size. In a computer simulation, smaller populations borrowed and replaced words faster than bigger communities. The author of that Gerbil grammar, Dixon himself, proposed another factor. He called Swadesh's idea the chimera of glottochronology, and argued instead that languages have long, stable periods, but then change in punctuated bursts during moments of social upheaval. So is that why Gerbil changed so much so fast? A small population and a quick punctuation? Well, a careful look at the switch from traditional Gerbil to young Gerbil suggests another variable, the biggest reason why the language changed so much in just decades. Language death. A few decades before Dixon's grammar, about 30 Dyirbalngan still lived around the upper Tully River, hanging on to the old ways. But these days, it seems like nobody is learning Gerbil, threatening even young Gerbil with extinction. It's not just assimilating to Australian English or turning into a bare-bones pidgin or Creole. This researcher tells us it's not that simple. Behind the steep change from traditional Gerbil to young Gerbil was the smooth oldest to youngest drop-off. Gerbil has been dying its own death, and language death is its own variable. With all these complexities, how long do we have to be out before we wake up to a brand new language? It depends. Some tongues seem to keep their shape over 1,000 years. Others do indeed change quickly within centuries. But take another look at that question we started with. How long can a language last before it becomes unrecognizable? Not unintelligible to earlier speakers, utterly unrecognizable. See, even if a time-traveling Gerbil speaker couldn't understand the language, they might still be able to pick out familiar words. How do we know this will happen? Because it has happened. This isn't the first time Gerbil has evolved. We got a glimpse of its past changes in Part 1, when we met a relative of Gerbil where the word for dog is dog. That word took linguistic know-how to prove it was actually related to Gerbil, not English. But other patterns among Australia's languages are easier to recognize. Whatever you think about Swadesh lists, here's a fun use for them. Compare basic vocabulary from a bunch of Australian languages and look for cognates. Comparing cognates and sound changes in grammar, linguists focusing on Australia's languages looked far back beyond Gerbil to recover its entire family. The pama-nyungan languages. There is dissent. Dixon in particular came to reject this grouping, but the consensus is that pama-nyungan constitutes the largest family on the continent by far. Using various lines of evidence, pama-nyungan is held to be around 4,000 to 5,000 years old. Which is intriguing, because look what happens when we estimate the ages of other language families. We get similar time depths. The one aberration here seems to be Proto-Afro-Asiatic, a story for another time. Some historical linguists warn that they don't do dates, but some that do see a limit here. Comparing languages can only take us several thousand years into the past. Of course, in my Tower of Babel first language video, we did meet some mavericks who dare to go even further. So, how long should we keep that hypothetical linguistics patient under to make sure they wake up to a changed language? Well, within hundreds of years, we could expect degraded intelligibility, with hand-waving on dates and exactly how understandable it will be. But within many thousands of years, even distant traces of the language may have dissolved. Though keep your apologies handy in case this answer is too vague for the Dyirbal Glottochronology. Stick around and subscribe for language.